Good morning. You are in for a treat today, and I am honored to introduce our chapel speaker today. Dr. Catherine Hayhoe is an accomplished atmospheric scientist who studies climate change, one of the most pressing issues facing humanity today. She has numerous publications and is a sought-after speaker around the world. In December, Dr. Hayhoe was invited to speak at the Nobel Peace Prize Forum. She has won many awards, including the American Geophysical Union's Award for Climate Communication. And just yesterday, she received the prestigious Snyder Award for Climate Science Communication. In 2014, Dr. Hayhoe was recognized by Time Magazine as one of the top 100 most influential people in the world, and by Foreign Policy as one of the top 100 global thinkers. Her work was featured on the Emmy Award-winning documentary series, Years of Living Dangerously. She's currently a professor and directs the Climate Science Center at Texas Tech University. Aside from all her accomplishments, Dr. Hayhoe may be best known to many people because of how she's bridging the broad, deep gap between scientists and Christians, something that not many can do well. This afternoon, Dr. Hayhoe will join Dr. Stephen Baumer-Prediger and APU alumna Ms. Annie McCauley for a panel discussion, Shalom in a Changing Climate. Hope you can join us in Sigurdsson Perry Lecture Hall at 3 o'clock. And now, for the very first time at Azusa Pacific University, would you help me warmly welcome Dr. Catherine Hayhoe.
Thank you. It's great to be here with you today. As I was leaving my friend's house this morning, I noticed that a neighbor had the Christmas tree out for pickup. That's a little bit late, but it's a reminder that we have just ended the Advent season when we celebrate what every child who goes to Sunday school knows, which is that God's greatest gift to us is His Son. What did that gift bring us? It brought us many things, and three of those are, first of all, the fact that not only was He born, but He died, and that death brought us, that death brought us forgiveness. That's a big deal. It's hard to forgive ourselves, it's hard to forgive other people. Imagine God forgiving all of the sins of the world because of the death of His Son. So because of that gift, we have forgiveness, but there's more. It didn't just stop there. We also have new life. We were spiritually dead people who were buried and then raised to life with Christ so that we might be new creations. Forgiveness and a new life were not all, though. We were also given a new heart. He took out our heart of stone and replaced it with that heart of flesh. Now, these are amazing gifts, and you have probably heard chapel services, sermons, talks, Bible studies on these gifts that God has given us. But have you ever heard a talk or a sermon or had a Bible study on what God's second greatest gift might be? Now, I don't know for sure what that is, but I'm going to suggest to you that the second, or, you know, if you really want to argue, we could possibly go for third. The second greatest gift, after the gift of spiritual life, making us alive with Christ, the second greatest gift would be the gift of physical life. The idea that we were not, The idea that we were not created to float around in a void of empty black space. We were given the most incredible home you can imagine. A planet that is so unique and supports such an incredible diversity of life. A planet that gives us the air that we breathe. We don't often think about that, but as you take your next breath, think about living without air. It gives us the water that we drink, the food that we eat, the places that we live. Everything we have, everything we need physically is made from something from this home that God has given us. That's a pretty amazing gift, isn't it? Now, you know, in the early church, there were a lot of heresies going around, and one of the main heresies was Gnosticism, the idea that the physical didn't matter. And so John wrote his letters towards the end of the New Testament, specifically combating the idea that the physical didn't matter. And he said, no, Jesus came in the flesh. We touched him. We spoke with him. He ate and he drank. He was a human. And that is a key part of what we believe, is that God came to this planet in the flesh as a real physical being. So the physical matters to God, so it's no surprise that when he decided to give us a physical gift, that physical gift was the most incredible planet you could ever imagine. It doesn't just give us the services we need, the things we need, it gives us beauty. When you go out and you look at incredible species, you look at nature, you even see what's around us in the city today, all of that diversity was created by God for the pure joy and pleasure of it. Do we need 500 different owl species? Do we need all of these galaxies across the universe that we haven't even been able to see until we put a telescope in space? They're not needed. They're there for the beauty of it. Because that's what God created, and he allows us to enjoy that beauty with him. So how are we to respond to this physical gift that he gave us? In Genesis 1, there's a verse that probably many of us are familiar with. And the verse says, God said, let us make human beings in our image, reflecting our nature. But have you ever thought about the second half of the verse? Because the second half of the verse actually talks about why God did that. And again, this is something we learn in Sunday school, but we don't often go on to read the second half of the verse. Why did God make us in his image for a very specific purpose so that we could be responsible for every living thing that moves on the face of the earth? That's why we humans were created in God's image. So that often leads to a concept that we're familiar with. Imagine if you inherited or were given a piece of property by somebody who you love and respect more than anyone in the world. And they said, you are the sole owner of this property. You have entire dominion over this property. And imagine if you sucked out every ounce of good, every penny you could, and you left that property, you left that land, you left that company, a crumbling, smoking ruin full of trash. That reflects very poorly on what we think of the person who gave us the gift, as well as on how we exert our responsibility, our stewardship, or even our dominion over that. Whereas if you're given a company, if you're given land, if you're given a farm, and you invest in it, you make sure that everybody there is healthy, that the land is productive and fruitful. That's the type of stewardship that God talks about in the Bible. So out of this idea has come the concept of creation care. The idea that we are the stewards, we are to care for this creation that God has entrusted to us. But what we often miss out there is that we are not separate from creation. It's not living things over here and us humans over here. We are actually living things. I know, it's kind of a strange idea, isn't it? We are living things. We have responsibility for all living things, which includes us. It includes our brothers and our sisters. And today, as world population has grown exponentially over the past 300 years, there are many more people in the world today than there were back in Bible times. And because there's more people in the world, we also have many more issues in the world. This is a map simply showing the percentage of people in each area of the world that lives in poverty. A lot of the world is dark brown. Dark brown is over 75% of people in those areas live in poverty. I myself grew up as a missionary kid in Colombia. These are a couple pictures. You can pick me out probably pretty easily. And living there, growing up there, moving there from Canada, where I'm originally from, when I was 9 years old, you realize that when people are already vulnerable, and you may have had this experience yourself, you may know exactly what I'm talking about. When people are already vulnerable, when they're already living right at the line, when every paycheck already goes to pay for essentials, for food, for water, for nothing else, when disaster strikes, When you live up perched on the side of a hill and there's a heavy rain event and it sweeps away your entire neighborhood, there's no insurance to pay for it. Often there's no even advance warning to get out of the way. It made me realize that we are very vulnerable to what this planet throws at us. So the concept that we are living things too is really important here, because how does this connect to what I do? You may be saying, hang on, I thought she was a climate scientist. We haven't even mentioned that word yet. We're getting there. Our population grew so quickly because of a tremendous blessing. Around about 300 or 400 years ago, we figured out how to dig massive amounts of coal and gas and oil out of the ground and burn it to industrialize our society. We've moved on now from the way it looked in those days to something more like this and like this. And you may say, well, how is that a blessing? Do you know what life looked like? Do you know what life still looks like in places where people don't have access to low-cost energy? It replaced an enormous amount of human labor, replaced an enormous amount of labor that was done by women traditionally. It even helped the United States replace slave labor because the North was industrialized with fossil fuels. But as with all things, even though they provide tremendous benefits to us, I mean, imagine your life here and now without refrigeration, without electricity, without transportation, without the medicine of modern life. Even though it provides tremendous benefits to us too, it came at a cost, a very significant cost. The cost of coal in the United States is cutting off the tops of mountains, literally. Why does this matter? It matters because, as my friend Marianne writes, in these areas in Appalachia, mountaintop coal mining, coal removal is actually poisoning the waterways. It's leading to things like cancer, heart disease, birth defects, premature mortality. Things that we care about because we care about every living thing and person on this planet. Burning fossil fuels also contributes to air pollution. And air pollution has been around so long that we've basically gotten used to it. Used to it to the extent that we don't realize that it's an injustice, that people who cannot afford to live somewhere better are the ones who are most exposed to air pollution. Did you know, if you had to take a wild guess, in the United States, every year, on average, how many people do you think die from air pollution? Just take a wild guess in your head. 200,000. Now be honest, put up your hand if you had a number in your head that big or bigger. Okay, I see three hands. That's a lot. Imagine if Ebola killed 200,000 people in the United States every year. We would be in a very different situation than we are today. But because we've had it so long, we just get used to it. And not just because we've had it so long, it's because it disproportionately affects those who don't have the voice to speak out against it. It's worse in other places. If you look around the entire world, the numbers are staggering. 1 in 6 deaths around the entire world is due to some form of air, water, or soil pollution, the vast majority of it tied to how we get our energy. So the burden of extracting and using the resources that have given us the life that we are profoundly grateful for today, do not get me wrong, that burden falls disproportionately on those who suffer the least benefits from that use. And then there's this. Now, what you're looking at here, you can't actually see. What you see are just steam. It's just water vapor. What you don't see coming out of these smokestacks, whenever we burn coal or gas or oil, what you don't see are the heat-trapping gases that are released. Because by digging up and burning massive amounts of coal and gas and oil, we're releasing carbon into the atmosphere, far more carbon than would be there naturally. And it's wrapping an extra blanket around our planet that our planet does not need and was not designed to have. Imagine that you're in bed and think back 10 years or so. Your grandma sneaks in while you're asleep, like she always did with me, and puts an extra blanket on you. And you wake up sweating, saying, Grandma, I didn't need this extra blanket. That's what we're doing to our planet. We're wrapping an extra blanket around it that it did not need, and because of that, From year to year to year, our temperature goes up and down, but decade by decade by decade, it is ticking slowly upwards as we wrap a thicker and thicker blanket around our planet. Now, why does this matter? Because we're only talking about, you know, a 1.5 or 2 degree Fahrenheit increase so far. It matters because it's loading the dice against us. We naturally have a chance of rolling a double six. What's a double six? A record-breaking hurricane, a crazy wildfire season, an incredible series of rainfall and floods, a 5-year drought. If you live in California, you know what these dice look like. But what's happening as the planet warms is it's supercharging many of these events. So decade by decade, on these dice, one of the other numbers is being replaced with a six. And then another number is being replaced with a six. And all of a sudden, our chances of rolling those double sixes are going up and up and up. And we think something is different. Our risks are increasing because we have more people, we have more buildings, we have more infrastructure today. We have more poverty, more injustice, more insecurity today. And unfortunately, bad news comes in threes, right? We are also getting more frequent floods, stronger droughts, and stronger storms as a result of the very same ways of getting energy that have given us the benefits of our lifestyle today. So whether we live in North America or Southeast Asia, whether we live in Texas or Syria, we're feeling the impacts of these events. Droughts are a natural part of life in Texas and Syria and California. But we know that the California drought that was experienced this past decade was much longer and stronger because it occurred in a warmer world. We know that the drought in Syria that drove almost 1 million people into the cities and contributed to skyrocketing unemployment, which in turn helped to fuel the refugee crisis, we know that that drought was 2 to 3 times more likely in a warmer world. We also know that heat waves are getting more frequent. We know that what used to be permanently frozen ground up in the Arctic is thawing and crumbling. We know that storms along the coast are getting stronger and dropping much more rain than they used to. We care about a changing climate because it's taking the risks that we already face today and it's exacerbating them or making them worse. It isn't just about us where we live here. If you look around the world, who is the most vulnerable to these dice being loaded against them? It's the very people, now don't try not to blink here, it's the very people who live in the countries that are already poor, that are already vulnerable, that already don't have enough food to eat, or are dying of diseases that nobody should be dying from in 2019. The reason I care about climate change is because it's a threat multiplier. It's like we're pouring all of our prayers, our effort, our mission trips, our donations, our time. We're pouring everything we can into this bucket to help people who are suffering today, who don't have enough food to eat, who have no way to support their families, who don't even have families anymore, who have lost them due to conflict or refugee crises. We are trying to help our brothers and sisters, and our heart bleeds for them. But there's a hole in the bucket, and the hole is climate change, and the hole is getting bigger and bigger. The only reason I care about it is because it affects everything I already care about. So why do we care about a changing climate? It's not just because of us, it's because it affects real people today, especially the poorest and most vulnerable among us, the very ones who we are exhorted over and over again, the widows, the orphans, the poor, those are the very ones we are exhorted to care for. So let me bring this back full circle. What is the bottom line to why we care? It isn't because we're tree huggers. It isn't because we vote for a certain political party. The reason we care is because of who God has made us. Who has He made us? People who are fully forgiven, who do not have to act out of guilt. People who have a new life, who are new creations. And even most importantly of all, people who have a new heart, a heart of flesh, not a heart of stone, a heart in which God's love has already been poured out. So that when we love others as Christ loved us, we are simply expressing and pouring out the love that we have already received. That's why we care, because of who we already are. So how are we to act? Because we can't end without talking about, well, what are we supposed to do about this? How are we to act? As Christians, I firmly believe that we are to act in two key ways. The first way is out of love, not out of guilt. In Galatians, the Apostle Paul talks about how we have been called to freedom, not to bondage, not to a new set of rules and a new set of commandments. We have been called to freedom. But he says, don't use this freedom as an opportunity for the flesh. Rather, serve each other through love, for the entire law is fulfilled in one statement, namely, love your neighbor as yourself. The second way we're to act is not out of fear, but out of hope. My favorite verse in the entire Bible comes from Timothy. It's Paul giving advice to his young mentee, and he says something really important. He says, God has not given us a spirit of fear. No, God has given us a spirit of what? Power to act. We have the ability, we are empowered to act. He's given us a spirit of love to think of others, to have compassion on others over ourselves. And, I love this, a sound mind to make good decisions. Isn't that amazing? These are some pretty amazing gifts that God has given us. So what can we do, acting out of love, not guilt, acting out of hope, not fear? We are the body, and the body has as many different parts to it as you can imagine, with completely different functions. So as the body of Christ, one of the most important things we can actually do about it is what we're doing right now. And I talked about this in the TED Talk. They asked me to give a TED Talk, and I was like, well, what am I going to do? And I said, well, I'm going to talk about the most important thing you can do. Talk about it. Because did you know 3/4 of people in the entire U.S. don't even hear anybody else talk about this issue more than once or twice a year? Talking about it is so important. Talking about what? Well, we can talk about individual things that we do. Plant-based diets, eating lower down the food chain. Whenever it gets to the point of buying a car, consider a used plug-in or a hybrid. Saves you a lot of money. I want solar shingles. I haven't got enough money for them yet, but my husband gave me solar panels for Christmas, and I was so excited. It was the best present. If you're wondering what to do, check out this amazing organization, climatecaretakers.org, online. It's an online community where you sign up, and every month they send you one thing to do that we can do in community with each other, because that is how we function as the body of Christ. We can talk about what churches are doing, from thousand-year-old churches to churches that were just built last year. It doesn't have to be solar panels. You can just do an energy audit, save a bunch of money, decrease your operating budget, and use that money to help people. We can talk about what companies are doing. Some of the biggest companies in the world are already leading the way on this. But it isn't just about companies. It's about what's happening in some very unexpected places, like the biggest solar farm in the world is in Morocco. Who knew? Now you do. China actually has more wind and solar energy than any other country in the entire world, because they know that coal is bad for them. Living in Beijing used to be so bad for your health that it took 5 years off your life. And now they've shut down all the coal-fired power plants around Beijing. I love talking about what's happening in places where people don't even have access to any form of energy. If they do, it's just kerosene, which is very expensive. Imagine the freedom of being able to start your own business. You have a solar panel beside the road. You have all these cords coming out of it. People can charge their cell phones. There's new technology using pay-as-you-go solar, where people can actually pay, because people do have a lot of cell phones. You can pay on your cell phone for how much electricity you're able to afford. Your kids can do their homework at night. You can actually refrigerate food if you can save up to buy a refrigerator. The world is changing in ways that are really, really amazing and encouraging. And the most important thing we can do in talking about it, if you feel like, well, I'm just one voice, I'm just one person, join an organization, support an organization that shares your values and amplifies your voice. Young Evangelicals for Climate Action, MICA Challenge, Arasha, and more. There are all kinds of organizations of like-minded people who start from the same premise, the same basis that I talked about here. We care about this issue not because of what the world says we are. We care about it because of who God has made us in our hearts. And that's why, for me, I truly believe that caring about God's creation, which includes the people and all other living things that are already being affected by climate change today. Why? Because climate change is exacerbating hunger and poverty and injustice and refugee crises. Caring about that is a genuine expression of our faith. It is a faithful acceptance of the responsibility that we've been entrusted with by God. And lastly, I believe it's a true expression of God's love to the world. Because, again, to end with the words of the Apostle Paul, the only thing that counts is when our faith expresses itself through love. Thank you. Oh, you're dismissed.